Don't get me to say that I'll do it in the church, because obviously we know that that's not an appropriate spot.
Okay, well, but you do far, it on a train.
I would do it on a train. I would do it on a wall. I would do it...
Would you do it on the side of an office building, say here in Manhattan?
I mean, actually, inside an office building in Manhattan, it's not the kind of place that I want it to be seen. I want it to be seen...
How about the side of a deli? It's on a corner.
It all depends what I'm painting. You know what I'm saying? So if I'm painting a mural that needs to be seen, if I'm making... Every graffiti art has a message behind it.
Uh-huh.
So what if I'm going to try to have a message come across, I need the appropriate spot. If I need to do it in a handball court, I'm going to do it in a handball court. The object of doing it on the trains, when you were able to do it in New York City, was to have a museum.
A moving museum,
right,
I get
that
it.
That traveled from Brooklyn to the Bronx. It was uncensored. Everyone can see it. You know, I mean, it was just ill. Right now...
Is this vandalism to you?
Excuse me?
Is this vandalism?
Is it vandalism? No, it's not vandalism. I mean, obviously, you're going to have some guys that pick up a can of spray paint and do some vandalism, but they're vandals. I'm saying there's a difference between graffiti art and vandalism. Vandalism is vandalism.
You obviously have a message. You say you have a message. What if the people that see the message don't understand the message?
Well, if they don't understand it, I mean, they have, you know, they're able to have their own opinion. I mean, if they want to go with it and endorse it, that's fine. If they want to say that it's something negative, then that's fine, too, because I'm not doing it for the people that are going to say that it's bad. I'm doing it for my people, and I'm giving my message across that I want to give across. You know what I'm saying? Every society has its art form, and graffiti is the art form of this subculture that we call hip-hop.
I hear you. And I want to talk to TC about that, too, but let me ask you one more thing. On my way to work here today, this morning, I passed by the American Museum of Natural History.
Right.
For those of you who aren't in New York, big museum. It's on Central Park. It houses a lot of, particularly the dinosaur exhibits and a lot of...
And all that other stuff.
Exactly. And somebody had taken a spray can in one color and did what to me looked like... It was undeciphered. I could not decipher what it was. It was black spray paint. It was scribble across the front of it. It's a landmark building.
Right.
Is that art or is that vandalism?
What did it look like to you?
It bothered me, because I love great architecture, and it looked like it was defacing it.
So that was your opinion? I mean, bottom line, that was your opinion. You know what I'm saying? You're entitled to have your opinion, and I should be entitled to have my opinion.
And that person who did that is...
I'm not going to down anybody.
No, I'm not arguing with you. I'm just telling you.
I'm not going to down anybody. If their artistic talent is not up to par, if they feel like expressing themselves, then...
Wherever they want to, they should be able to.
To a certain point, I mean, you know, we're civilized people, you know what I'm saying? I mean, we all have a mentality that, you know, we can handle and understand. I mean, we know what's right and wrong.
Okay, let me move next to you. TC, if graffiti's art, then why isn't it more widely accepted? Why don't more people see that?
Because as long as these rich elitists that's running this planet... You know, they feel that, well, Michelangelo, Leonardo da Vinci was graffiti artists. They tagged it still up. You know, so as long as these rich elitists accept something that's art like the American Museum of History, you know, and people are being oppressed, as long as there's someone doing the oppression and people being oppressed, you always going to have people on the underground expressing themselves.
Yeah, like, I hear what you're saying, but how is it the same as like Michelangelo?
What's the difference? Anytime they want to advertise anything to the black and Latino community, they put it in an artistic way where we can relate to it so that we can buy that. But see, if it's not accepted by the rich elitists in this country, on this planet, it's vandalism.
Okay.
But the first, we have to also
let
take
me introduce
into consideration.
Next, but I will say, when they want to sell a product to a white housewife in middle America, they also put it in a style, in a form, in an art that will appeal to her as well. You know what I mean?
How many housewives you know live in the ghetto? You know what I'm saying?
No, but I'm saying, they create advertising appropriate to the audience wherever they are, whether the ghetto or they're
check this out, Charlie. Right? What we did,
Charlie.
Charlie. Right? Is that one in the ghetto? Brothers and sisters didn't have football teams, hockey teams, tennis teams, or things of that nature to basically outlet their talent. So we had to make use of what we had.
Okay.
Expression through art. I mean, you see art, for example, why they have...
You didn't have an outlet.
Right, well, why they want to put a ban on graffiti in this country is because, one, it's propaganda.
Okay.
Propaganda against what? The system.
If you go to
all
Europe,
right, I hear that. If, I hear that.
If,
I hear.
If you go to Europe, if you go to Europe, they praise graffiti art.
Praise it.
Yeah,
praise
they do,
it.
And they also praise buy and sell it on canvases. I don't know how they feel if you put it on the Louvre or you put it on the Eiffel Tower.
If you
they
see
might feel
the
a little different about
trains,
it.
The European trains are full of graffiti, like we were in 1979.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, they have art shows with graffiti. I mean, they just adore graffiti. You know what I'm saying? Because and they see graffiti as the art of America because it was created in America. And the technique that they, for graffiti.
I hear what you're saying. We can't get into that right now because I want to introduce all the men up on stage, but we'll get back to that, okay? Sitting next to here, next to you is my next guest. They say graffiti isn't just about artistic ability, it's about crime. In less than 1 hour, a graffiti artist can cause up to $15,000 worth of damage. Please welcome New York State Assemblyman Tony Seminario, and sitting next to him is the president and founder of the Guardian Angels, Curtis Sliwa. Welcome to the show, gentlemen. Now, Tony, for years you've been fighting against graffiti, and in its most recent incarnation, your fight has taken on a proposed bill that has to do with paddling, right?
Paddling and going to jail. The judges have the right to send them to jail.
Well, tell us about that bill.
I mean, I gave you the courtesy. You gonna get let me finish?
No problem. Okay. You got the respect.
Thank you.
Handle your business.
Okay. Now, getting back to what we were saying. Number one, I feel the community and my whole community feels one. Why should they have the right to put graffiti on private buildings, on homeowners' buildings, on cars? They have the audacity to do a car. They do it on mailboxes. Mm-hmm. I mean, because it's their whim to say. It's their art. And if they feel it's such a great thing, why do they do it between the hours of 12 and 5 in the morning? You never see them do it during the day, where the citizenry out there could come out and watch them. Mm-hmm. You understand? It's always at night. We have patrols in my area, in the 38th Assembly District.
Where you live?
The 38th in Glendale.
Let him finish, okay?
And everything. We're out there at night trying to track these guys down. I mean...
Well, it doesn't sound to me like your problem is... graffiti, the actual what they do. Your problem seems to be where they put it.
Definitely. Look, I'm concerned in my district.
How because much money have you spent combating it?
So wait, if
you put some of that money into maybe making a program for the children to paint, I bet you that the problem of the kids sporadically painting will stop
legal
if they
war.
Have some kind of a program.
Stand, let me get a comment here for a second.
One third of that money doing a program. I mean, honestly, we're talking honestly. One third of that money, just do a sample program. And you'll see that if the kids have an outlet where they can actually paint and something positive, because graffiti is actually energy. Take that energy that these kids have and use it in a positive way. Don't try to fight it.
Painting mailboxes and cars and everything else,
so
you know that they got no mentality.
Do they have
Curtis,
another option?
Brim, hold up for a sec. Let me get this comment here. What do you want to say?
$7 billion? I could spend $500 million and get rid of all the graffiti in America and have every kid who writes graffiti today in America would have a job and they would
How would you do this?
I would go into every community with enough money to give these kids the support they need from an early enough age to feel good about themselves, to promote self-esteem in the neighborhoods.
Curtis, go ahead, jump in here.
You know, I've been sitting here listening to this rolling propaganda. Let's tell it like it is. Graffiti artists call themselves CIA, criminals in action. You know what that means? They're spray can toting, dope sucking, out of control, psychopathic,
right.
Vandalizing machines. And where do you think they get this paint from? Let me tell you, Charlie. They go into the big and tall men's shop to get daddy's clothes, big pants, big suits,
has graffiti as a sign. So what is he saying?
And steal it and rob. And it begins the criminal activity. It's all about committing crime.
I've heard what you each have to say. We'll be back in a minute. We'll hear the rest of this conversation.
Go into mom and dad's house and start spraying it up the wall and you'll bust your backside.
All right, have a seat, Curtis. We're going to be back with the rest of this conversation. Also, when we return, we'll hear how far some people will go for their graffiti art. We'll be right back. What do you think? Stand up here. We're back, and we're talking about graffiti art. Now, you had a comment you wanted to make.
This is a question for Bram. Bram, earlier you said two things. One, that graffiti was an art form, that it was beautiful, and you're beautifying the area. You also said that you wouldn't put it up in a church, obviously feeling in your heart that that's the wrong place, people go there, et cetera, et cetera. My question to you is, what makes it right to put it up on someone else's property when it's their own property, and you say it's, you shouldn't put it up in a church? Where's the distinction?
I'm not going to sit here and say that every place that there's a graffiti marking is an appropriate place. I'm not saying that, bottom line. But what I'm saying it is that graffiti is just a superficial problem. I mean, you can say, you know, it's bad, but there's a lot of stuff behind it. You know what I'm saying? Like I'm telling this guy here, he's a politician and he's in power, and obviously he's been elected by the public, and he has no problem giving contracts out to eradicate graffiti. Mm-hmm. If they spend a little bit of that money trying to create a program, then that's solving part of the problem.
I hear that. Thank you for your comment. Tony, this gentleman's basically saying that if you put it, you know not to put it on a church, that means that somewhere deep inside you know there's something probably not right about it.
They know it's wrong to put it on property. They know it's wrong to face public property and everything. I mean, they're talking about setting up classes and everything else. If they didn't do the graffiti, we wouldn't have that expense.
There's been graffiti since the beginning of time, man.
Curtis,
let them go to art school to perfect their art.
All right. Curtis, jump in here.
That's what we're up against. That's what we're up against. That's why we can't do nothing.
If so good, they could get somebody to commission them to do the piece on the business side. But why is it they feel the need to rob the paint, go into the train, bomb the buses, attack public facilities, private, and don't tell me, you guys don't hit synagogues and churches, because I haven't seen a clean synagogue and church lately.
First of all, me personally, I've been out on bombing missions with some of your Guardian Angel members front of your headquarters on 8th Avenue.
Our mission,
there's graffiti even
mission,
on your van, and your wife supports graffiti.
All right, guys, hold up. Let me introduce my next guest. I'll get back. What do you want to say, Chris?
One very important question. If he feels like graffiti is such a nasty thing,
why is it on his headquarters?
Why
is it on their van?
Why is it on their van?
On their headquarters?
You know, saying Guardian Angels, why is it on the headquarters?
It's good. Good question. Let's let him answer it. Hold on, audience. No. I've got to move on to my next guest. I want Curtis to answer that.
Well, they brought up the name Michelangelo before. They didn't mention he was commissioned by the Vatican to paint the Sistine Chapel. That's exactly what
he was. He was a graffiti artist.
Oh, no, he was.
He was a graph artist.
We commissioned an artist to do a piece on our headquarters and on the church.
Michelangelo was commissioned.
We decided to have it.
Michelangelo was commissioned because they found the drawing on the streets in war.
You do the same thing.
All right, guys. Hold up. Curtis.
And you're
going to move on to my next guest. But there is a distinction here. Neither of them are saying they have a problem with the art itself. That's not what they're saying. Okay. Listen, there are two conversations going on here. Their conversation is they don't have a problem with graffiti art. They have a problem with putting it on property that's not yours. You guys are saying the problem is not about graffiti. It's about something else, and I want to get into that in a moment. Let me introduce my next guest. Now, my next guest says he's an artist, but the courts say he's a vandal. He just got out of jail for serving a 3-month sentence for graffiti-related crimes. Please welcome Wiz Art. Thanks for being here. Sitting next to him is Vase. Now, Vase, you're in pretty much the same position, not in terms of jail, but in terms of having the same opinions about art as Wiz Art. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to start with Wiz Art. Wiz Art, why is graffiti so important to you that you were willing to go to jail for it?
Because it's a way for me to express myself, get my artwork out, let people see my true feelings of me as a person, and still be able to catch fame from other graffiti artists and you know, and to know that I had the chance to paint with a spray can and learn it and master it and appreciate everybody else's art as good as mine.
Okay, Vase. I hear his point, but how are people supposed to understand what they don't necessarily understand? If they look at it and it doesn't communicate whatever your message is, what's the communication?
They have to learn it. It's just part of the street to say, you know? You know, they just got to learn it.
You tell that to a guy who owns a house worth $200,000, well, and finds graffiti on the side of his house.
There's many different ways of graffiti. You have a graffiti artist, you have a graffiti tagger, and you have a vandal.
Well, whatever that is.
A vandal
graffiti.
Is someone who don't have skills, who doesn't know what
they're
doing.
What's the difference? Yeah.
I'm trying to say, A vandal is one who doesn't have skill, don't know what they're doing, just go out to destroy. And a toy is someone who's trying to learn and he's getting up. And then there's an artist who has spent many years practicing and upgrading it to where it's an art level.
Everybody's
I work for Flight Snowboards.
So you say there is a
Flight
difference.
Snowboards. I painted their bus for $2,000. I gotta go to break here.
One question for you. The scribble that I saw in the front of the American Museum of Natural History this morning, that was okay, it's not necessarily art. All right, fine. We're going to break. We'll be right back. All right, we're back and we're talking about graffiti art in America. Is it art or is it vandalism? You wanted to say something.
Yeah, let's go to the real world. The real world is the homeowner, the property owner, the businessman. They don't want graffiti on their property. It's against the law, yet they have the audacity to go out there and they don't care. And when they do it, they do it under the cover of darkness. Because I guarantee you, if they ever, well, you
do it right here.
I do it right here.
Hold on, hold on.
I do it right here. You come to Queens. You come to Queens and do it in the daytime. We'll accommodate you.
People
right,
elect
what do you want
him.
To say?
He's supposed to do it. He works for the people.
Not his neighborhood. They're my people, not your people.
Your people?
Not your graffiti
artists. You don't live where we live, know what I'm saying? You're sitting there like a racist.
I came from where you came from.
Listen,
I was brought up in a poor area. I came from East New York and Brooklyn.
All right, hold on.
I never in my life would defend anybody's property.
Tony.
The full mentality.
It has moved beyond.
Tony.
It has moved beyond.
Guys, quiet up. Brim.
It has gone into designing clothes.
Brim, you can't all talk at the same time, all right? Tony, this gentleman said you don't come from his neighborhood.
But where he came from, John.
My question to you is not whether you come from his neighborhood. What I want to know is, is there graffiti in your neighborhood?
All over the neighborhood.
That's what matters. That's the point of the conversation.
When he, hey, Charles, hello. When he's running for office, does he put posters up all over the place? When he's running for office, does he put posters up all over the place? Stickers and billboards and all that other stuff.
But here's the deal, Brim. If this guy runs for office and he stands up and says, I'm against graffiti on your buildings, and the people in his community elect him, then that's the message they want to say, or they wouldn't elect
them. What's the difference between the graffiti that's on 42nd Street Times Square with the same Krylon spray can, all right, on 42nd Times Square between a tag or a drop that's in the ghetto someplace?
Charlie,
is that art? Or is
Charlie,
that
let's look at something we could all agree on. You go on a highway, a freeway, and all of a sudden you see a sign that's
you're running for office and you're on one side of politics. You just got nothing to say.
Spray painting with graffiti. That could be your mother.
Okay.
That could be your grandmother.
Listen, guys, we're not getting anywhere right now. I want to introduce my next guest. We're not getting anywhere right now.
No,
I want to introduce my guest. My next guest is graffiti artist and rapper Fat Joe. Give him a hand. Joe, come on out. Hey, Joe, welcome to the show. Now, you bring a different angle to this because you say graffiti has something to do with hip-hop.
Excuse me?
You say graffiti has something to do with hip-hop, right? What does it have, what
does
it have to do with
hip-hop? There's like three elements in hip-hop. There's the verbal, which is what I do, the rap. I also do the graffiti, which is the visual hip-hop. And there's also the b-boying, which commercial society labeled it as breakdancing. That is another category of hip-hop.
Okay, what do you say to the person who says, well, somebody who lives in their apartment building, say on the Upper East Side, and says, I don't want to listen to hip-hop, so I don't. So why do I have to see hip-hop art if I don't want to? I mean, you don't force people to listen to the music, so isn't putting the art on their building forcing them to see it?
I wouldn't agree with that. I mean,
it's just a question.
Hip-hop is just like, you know, is just like a whole culture. That's just, graffiti's a part of the culture, mm-hmm. which has caused rap to become so large in this corporate industry and stuff like that. And of course we rap and you gotta listen to it on the radio. If you don't wanna listen to it on that station, then you'll change it to another station. It's the same thing.
Like it on your building, you change to another building?
Nah, that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is like, That's not even a question I want to answer. I just want to, you know what I'm saying?
Okay. I appreciate your honesty there, though.
Yeah, I want to support graffiti art because it's been down since day one. And I'm a graffiti artist.
I hear what you're saying. It's part of the whole culture. I got to go to break now, though. When we come back, I want to talk about how some of you guys would feel if art you didn't like showed up on your homes. But first, Fat Joe, take us a break.
One, two. Everybody get up and represent the true hip hop. Y'all know this joint. Yeah, money. This is going out to the people like my man Curtis who forgot the ghetto. Know what I'm saying? And all the graffiti artists. What's up, yeah, is the key to sex. The life is getting, yeah, sing along, check it, yo. What's up for cats? Juice for rappy front sass, threes for all the 40 crews, corner crews devour, force for graffiti power, be the top dollar scholar, rock and go collars, why you trying to sip the juice?
Introducing the...
Curtis, you got something you want to say?
Oh, yeah.
No way.
If only we could transport everybody here to Singapore, a system that deals with graffiti vandals the right way. They take you to court, if they find you guilty, they hit you with the rattan. That means they cane you like they did Michael Faye. And you know this, they don't have a problem with vandalism and graffiti. They deal with it appropriately. And they sent that American package, his backside, his fanny was hot and flaming. And that's the way we ought to deal with it here.
I tell you what, right? First and foremost, as a black man living in New York and in America, I'll be damned if I'm gonna let somebody beat my kid that hasn't brought my kid into this world. That's Singapore, that's New York.
Your ex-wife supports graffiti. Hold up, Fat Joe. I'm gonna introduce my next guest, okay? They stand against graffiti in every way, shape, or form, and they believe it is vandalism. Please welcome to the show Scott and Peter. Give them a hand. Now, I'm gonna ask you all to calm down for a second and just be quiet and listen to what they have to say. Let's hear their story, okay? Scott, what is your problem with graffiti artists?
Well, basically, our family, we have approximately $1 million building that that my grandfather actually built. And when the graffiti happens on ours, I'm not saying that it isn't art. It really is art. The problem is that it was done on our building, and I didn't contract it, and I didn't want it on there.
Well, try to contract it.
Well, hold on one second.
Let him finish.
Let me ask you this. One of our businesses, we got three companies in ours. One of them is advertising promotional. And graphic artists in our business get paid very good money. And you gentlemen actually have a really good talent that's out there that you can make good money at. And what I'm saying is basically, I don't like it on my building because I didn't contract it. And I'm sure that's what these gentlemen are also saying.
Hold on.
Just for the home audience that didn't hear what she said when she called out, she said, why don't you give them a contract? Go ahead.
Basically, how come you don't come to my business and buy from me? You got to get out there and sell. So you go into your businesses and you try to sell.
You give us the front door.
Do you think they do not treat themselves and their art as a business?
I would have to agree with that. I think if you probably tried to do it as a business, they could probably make a very good living off of it.
You're not doing it as a business.
What connections could a kid from the ghetto doing this graffiti art have when an executive in the corporate industry? It's not what you know, it's who you know. So sure people make a lot of money off of graphic art, but it'll be your cousin John, your cousin Jim. It won't be a graffiti artist.
Colin Brow is from the South Bronx. What connection did he have?
The way like they speaking over here, it's like it's a racial problem. Okay, you said how you don't even, you said that. Okay, he said, hello, he okay, he says how he doesn't like it on his building. I understand that, right? But you said that you like it and they could get some good money off of it. Why don't you offer these guys a contract and everything?
No, I think his point is, his point is not that he wants to have a contract for art on his building. If he chose to have art on his building, then he would contract someone to put it on.
Exactly.
It doesn't mean that he wants the art on there.
It's still a prejudice issue here. With Because that's how you making it sound. That's how you making it sound, talking about Bronx and East New York and everything like that.
You're making it, because where you getting East New York, Bronx, why you saying all of that for?
I was born in East New York.
You're not talking about Greece. You're talking about something else.
When he mentioned the ghetto,
let me ask you something. Let's talk about the graffiti for a minute, okay?
Hold on,
Curtis.
There are more white graffiti artists in America from the suburbs than all the graffiti artists from the ghettos combined.
Why you keep on saying that for?
Curtis, hold up. Ladies, have you ever had graffiti on your homes where you live?
No.
If you did,
I wouldn't want nobody to come. I live in a house. I wouldn't want nobody to come and write it on the side of my house. But,
thank you. That's the whole point of the conversation.
They have a $1 million industry. Why can't they just,
I have to introduce this next man. Sitting here also is Peter. Now, Peter, do you consider these gentlemen and ladies who do graffiti artists?
Do I consider graffiti art?
Yeah.
Graffiti is art.
Thank you.
But if you have the permission of the canvas,
okay,
meaning the building that it's applied to.
Okay. On that note, we're going to break. Is graffiti art? Does it have a hidden message? We'll find out in a second. Don't go away. Something, okay?
This is a small business. I'm a family business. Parents, grandparents, myself, that kind of deal. So we're a small business. When the graffiti came to our building, it cost us about $2,000 to try to paint it. And then the insurance company said, hey, your building's been graffitied too much. We're not going to get up there and pay for it anymore.
So you have to pay for it every time it happens.
Out of our pockets now.
Let me get back to Artie for a second.
Did you do graffiti on trains? You did graffiti on trains. Who gave you permission to do that? Don't give me this old law and order stuff. I mean, you stole that paint to do it, and you committed a crime.
All right, gentlemen. Hold on, Artie, what are you saying here?
Let's hear what he's saying.
What do you have in your hand, Artie?
This is a advertisement from a recent hip hop magazine for ultra wides and mini wides.
Right.
These are tools.
Right. Do you not use them?
What are ultra wides and mini wides? They're spray cans.
I'm going to ask you something simple and quick.
I don't understand what he's talking about. Right. Please let him finish.
This is a marker full with paint, advertised in a recent hip hop magazine. For $9, you send to the magazine, they send you this. This is what you guys refer to as an ultra wide. On the advertisement, this is what it's for. Subways, buses, walls, and windows. What type of art are you going to do with this on those places?
We don't make the markers.
Those markers
go ahead.
Were made for making signs and posters
like that.
Okay,
guys,
I've got to go to break here. Let me get some quick comments. What do you
want to
say?
I just want to address what they had spoken about as far as like an artist bettering themselves and putting together a graphic firm or something like that. Me, myself, with a partner, we have a company called Cartel, and basically we've done everything from Wu-Tang,
Clan. So you've done that?
I've done it. I better myself. I'm a graffiti artist, too. I do well.
But you know what?
That's what I'm talking about.
I'll challenge you to this. If that gentleman down there is a small business, is considered a corporation in some people's minds, then you are too. So I hope you put a hand back and help reach out to some people in the community as well as this gentleman down here.
The whole point I wanted to make was, just like he might have a business, and Fat Joe was trying to explain, we don't have connections like that. Through the record companies, I have walls put up in front of me myself because my stuff is a little too street or a little too urban.
I hear that.
Hopefully somebody
will hear you on the show maybe, okay? I don't know. I got to go to break. We'll be right back.
Fat Joe's hat.
Don't go away. Please welcome my next guest from the St. Petersburg, Florida Center for the Arts, Dr. Carl Hollander. Thank you for being here. Well, thank you for being here. And what I want to know is, how are you providing an outlet for graffiti artists?
Charles, we have a program in St. Petersburg where we are coupling graffiti artists with professional artists that work for commercial companies like Eller Media that do the billboards in Florida. And they are learning a trade, as it were, so that they can get out there and get jobs. Eller couples these artists up through that training program with different corporations so that they can use their skills.
You're finding a place for them in the world
right.
of work,
We're trying to help them use their potential within the community.
So is it working?
Well, you know, that's a long-run kind of answer. We don't know.
We'll see. Okay.
Our problem right now is primarily now only with the taggers. The graffiti artists, the kids that really have potential, have found a niche in the community and are helping the younger kids that are there. I would say that our next step and the next step in this is to take the graffiti artists and bring them to the community centers and let them start to teach the younger kids how to develop their skills
That's
in the art world.
About. That's what we're talking about. That's what I'm talking about, man. Yo, I gotta say something. I think my man right there, you got some soul in you because you try to look out for younger brothers. Brothers are trying to do their thing. As for y'all, you don't see no black people. You don't see no Puerto Ricans up there arguing like y'all arguing. You know why? Because we understand that.
It's not
we
a
understand
black
what
and
the
white
brothers are trying to do. We understand what the brothers are trying to do.
It's not black and white.
I hear you. Graffiti fans. Hold on. Have a seat. Have a seat, please. Have a seat. Have a seat.
Let's clarify that.
Gentlemen, we can't understand you when you all scream out at the same time.
That's right. There are thousands of artists out there who don't do graffiti. They can't sell their work, but they don't go putting it on buildings, on buses, on churches, on synagogues.
They're ruining our community.
They're
destroying our community.
Then keep it in your house. Hang it in your
Curtis,
house. Not on somebody
please.
Else's house.
Paint your own car.
Yes,
paint your own room. Leave our cities alone.
Excuse me, gentlemen. I'm trying to let this lady speak. We're almost out of time.
Before I ask my question, I'd like to comment that the graffiti that you artists portray on buildings, and I agree. I think it's real talent. I think you've got talent if you can do that. But if, say, something you work for and buy, would you like someone ruining that? I'm not saying art is ruining
That's
it, but
choice.
If
we
you don't
come
want
to a
that
compromise.
On there, would you like me to put
we
something on there?
We gotta come to a compromise and understand each other and hear each other out.
Can you feel what she's saying?
Like, if you work hard for the money that you earn and you buy a car, graffiti's all over it.
They're not coming to a compromise.
Guys, you know what? The first compromise I'm going to break is for you guys to hear a little bit of what she's saying and for her to hear a little bit of what you're saying. And I want to thank Carl Hollander for at least giving us a possibility. Lethal Solution, we'll be right back with some words from you, our viewers. We'll be right back. Welcome back. We've been talking about graffiti as art or vandalism, you know, but we're going to stop for a minute and take a letter from a viewer. Here we go. Boom. This viewer writes, Dear Charles, I just watched your show, and it was about guests who only date outside their race, if any of you saw that. I'm especially writing because I can't stand one of your past guests who was on your show. His name was Taylor, and he said he only dates outside his race. I thought he was very ignorant, and I think he should grow up. If I had the chance, I would confront him also because I feel there's nothing wrong with dating outside your race, but I do think it is wrong to only date outside your race. All right, that letter was from Tiffany in Ann Arbor, Michigan. Thanks for writing, Tiffany. Now, just as we finish the show here, I want to thank you, Carl Hollander, and you guys, all of my guests, because if you're a city official out there, if you're somebody who is a graffiti artist, and you're interested in the compromise that guys like Brim and TC talked about, think about what Mr. Hollander said. Maybe that's a way for the cities and these artists to get together and to make a difference. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.